blown away to By the Time I Get to Phoenix. Jimmy Webb is one of music's greatest songwriters. He's written hits for the likes of Barbara Streisand, Frank Sinatra, and his good friend Glen Campbell. One of his songs was also used in the 1970s as Channel 10 station ID. Well, Jimmy is in the country, and Ange Bishop caught up with him for this morning television exclusive. Galveston, oh,
Galveston. He's written hits for everyone from Frank Sinatra to Glen Campbell.
Jimmy, it's so great to have you back in Australia, and it's such a thrill to catch up with you.
Thank you.
When did you first know that you could write a song?
My mother put me on the piano when I was 6 years old, and we had this sort of informal covenant that if I played the piano for 30 minutes every day, she wouldn't hit me with a stick.
Oh, wow.
So that worked out pretty well.
Lucky you didn't grow to hate it.
Yeah, yeah, well, I was indifferent to it, really. The passion really started stirring when I was 12, 13, 14 years old. I had a couple of really good teachers who really awakened me.
And then what about the lyrics?
I'm an avid book reader. I was reading Stranger in a Strange Land. And I was being crafty about it because I was in Sunday service. And right in the middle of my father's sermon, he said, "Jimmy Lane," like that. And I put my head up and he says, "Would you like to bring that book up front here and show all the folks what you've been reading?" And he looks at my science fiction book and he says, "Stranger in a Strange Land." He said, "I guess that must be Jesus, right?" I was a sailor. I started out wanting to make a living as a songwriter, and I would actually pray and say, "Dear God, please let me make a living, you know, writing songs, you know."
Have you made a living from it, Jimmy?
I've managed, you know, but I remember that my father saying, "This songwriting thing is just going to break your heart." And I remember being banished to the garage. The piano and all, everything went to the garage, because he did not like the direction I was going in at all. Would you like to ride
in my beautiful? What was the turning point?
I think it was the 10th Grammy Awards, the spring of 1968, when I had two songs nominated in the best song category.
Up, Up and Away.
And By the Time I Get to Phoenix. And I had thrown over all hope of winning anything. And I thought, I'm just going to go and have a good time. And no one could have been more surprised when they said, "And now for Song of the Year, Jimmy Webb, Up, Up and Away." The world's a nicer place in my beautiful. And then, as you know, it went out of control. I OD'd on something that I was unaware of what this substance was.
What was it you took in the end, do you know? Did you ever identify it?
It was PCP.
Good God.
I had taken enough PCP to kill an elephant. It went beyond scary a couple of times because it was like probably a month later when I finally remembered how to play the piano again. I would look at it, I knew it was a piece of equipment, but for the life of me, I couldn't tell you what the keys, the relationships were, or sometimes I would hit it and I would hear the noise come out of it.
You could have lost everything.
The worst thing is that I could have survived it and lost my ability to play the piano.
Do you despair a little today when you hear a song whose entire lyrics are "Give it to me, baby, all night long"?
Lyrics have retreated in significance. It reminds me of the days when Steve Allen used to read from a podium and he would read, "I can't get no satisfaction." I think that's my real concern is for the mental health here of the people involved. I still see her
standing by the water. I have to ask you about Glen Campbell.
Yes, ma'am.
He is such a good friend of yours. He's got Alzheimer's disease. When did you last see him, and what's the latest?
He's doing as well as can be expected, because this disease is not a good disease. And Glenn's well along. He's past performing. I mean, there was a time there towards the end when he was fourth stage, which is debilitating. People don't do much when they're that sick.
Right. Yeah.
He was playing. He was playing concerts.
Yeah.
And I know that he was terrified as well, because he knew he had Alzheimer's. And yet he would go on stage knowing that he might screw up.
I am a lineman for the county.
Well, I remember one time in Australia, he played Wichita lineman twice. He played it once, and everybody gave him a great big Australian standing ovation, and the guys in the back of the Fosters were like, well, that's... While they were cheering him, he started the song again. Oh my God, but it's the same song, it's Wichita Lineman. Well, he did it even better. So the audience now, they go absolutely silent at the end because no one knows how to react. And these Aussies started chanting in the back at first. Do it again. Do it again. Do it again. You know, like that? And that's why I love the Australians.
Come to some lyrics of yours that people are always asking about, and in fact form the title of your book, Cake in the Rain, MacArthur Park. What it means, why the cake was left in the rain,
well,
all of the above.
You'll have to read the book. I'm willing to say that MacArthur Park was a real place, and that everything that you hear about in MacArthur Park, the old men playing checkers with the tree, the cake, the icing, the rain, the girl, the yellow dress, all of that's real. Those are real images from my memory. It's a song about loss.
So many great songs.
So many great cakes.
No, brilliant. Because that's my era, the 60s, and I remember all of those songs.
And songs with stories. That's why he's saying he doesn't like the songs of today. That you actually told a story and took people on a journey with a song.